Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the second meeting in 2021 of the Scottish Commission for Public Audit. We move first to agenda item one, which seeks the agreement of members to taking agenda items 4 and 5 in private. If any member disagrees, please type N in the chat function. Are we all agreed? No member has objected, therefore we are agreed. I'll now move on to agenda item 2. And agenda item 2 is consideration of Audit Scotland's spring budget revision 2021-22 budget adjustment. Members have a copy of the spring budget revision budget adjustment in their meeting papers. Now, I'd like to welcome to the meeting Alan Alexander, Chair of the Board of Audit Scotland, Stephen Boyle, Auditor General for Scotland, Martin Walker, Acting Director of Corporate Services, and Stuart Dennis, Corporate Finance Manager, Audit Scotland. And at this point, I'd just like to put on record the Commission's thanks to Diane McGiffin, who's just recently left her role as Chief Operating Officer of Audit Scotland. She's taking up a new position as Chief Executive of the Law Society of Scotland. And I'm sure everybody will join me in thanking Diane for all her work over the past 20 years and to wish her well in her new role. With Diane's departure, I'd like to welcome Martin Walker to his first appearance before the Commission in his role as Acting Director of Corporate Services. I would now invite Alan Alexander and then the Auditor General to make any short introductory remarks.
Here on the matter of the spring budget revision, I'd appreciate it if you went to Stephen first and then came back to me for the rest of the agenda. In other words, he'll make the opening statement on the spring budget adjustment, and I'll do the one on the budget proposal.
Okay, that's grand. Stephen?
Thank you, Chair. Good morning, everybody. And I'm happy to say a couple of introductory remarks to the spring budget revision. And if you're content, Chair, maybe I'll say I'll make a fuller opening remark following Professor Alexander on the budget proposals. The spring budget revision request, as ever, Chair, relates to Audit Scotland's pension arrangements, our membership of the for the vast majority of Audit Scotland staff of the local government pension scheme, which is a defined benefit scheme supported by assets and subject to valuation by the scheme's actuaries. Each year, employers such as Audit Scotland have to make accounting disclosures and, if necessary, accounting adjustments to reflect the result of the valuations based on actuarial assumptions. From the information that we've been provided by the scheme's actuaries, this has resulted in a spring budget revision request to the Commission of £6 million for the financial year 21-22. The background to this relates to changes in assumptions, in particular to changes to the discount rate. A reduction in the discount rate that the actuaries are using, and that has an effect of increasing the liabilities of the scheme and the associated share that the respective employer members such as Audit Scotland recognise. Lastly, Chair, just to advise the Commission that Audit Scotland is in discussions with the Scottish Government Finance Directorate to highlight the financial implications and the requirements for this across all of Scotland's public bodies that will make these accounting adjustments, where their funding comes from central government parliamentary sources, is covered by what's known as AME funding, annually managed expenditure, to reflect the non-cash adjustment, and that funding, subject to confirmation negotiation, is due to be received from HM Treasury. Chair, happy to pause there, and I suspect between myself and Stuart Dennis would be delighted to answer any of the Commission's questions.
Thank you, Auditor General. I'd remind witnesses and members to take a short pause before speaking so that the broadcast team have time to switch your mic on. If any member has a supplementary to a question, please type R in the chat box and I'll bring you in just as soon as I can. As always, I'm grateful if the questions and answers can be as tight as possible. Auditor General, this non-cash accounting adjustment, it seems to come up every year, regular as clockwork. I can't remember when it last went the other way. And I guess as regards the Lothian Pension Fund, you stated you've had some discussions with the Scottish Government. Are we satisfied that the previously agreed arrangements with HM Treasury remain in place to meet this pension adjustment?
Yeah, I'm happy to answer both those points, Chair, actually, and Stuart, we may want to come in and start update the Commission on where we are with the discussions with both the funding and Treasury. It has been subject to fluctuation in terms of whether it's an increase in budget requirements or a reduction over the years. Our expectation, though, is that we will continue to seek support from the Commission for additional AMEI funding budget approval, both this year and probably also in years to come, if the trend in real assumptions holds good, that discount rates will fall. Of course, none of us have will be able to have any strong degree of confidence. Even in the past week or so, we've changes from the Bank of England on interest rates for the first time in many, many years. There is undoubted variability in the rates of discount that will be used to measure the assets and liabilities of the scheme. In terms of confidence about the HM Treasury's support, Stuart can say a wee bit more, but I think we would say that it's a well-trodden path, Chair, of AMEI funding support in totality for what's a non-cash adjustment. Ultimately, it is rooted in accounting disclosures, which need to be correct and proper, but there are no flow of funds directly from central government, UK government to Scotland. Merely need to have sufficient budget cover. But I will pause there and just see if Stuart wishes to add anything about if there's any more detail that we can.
Thank you, Stephen. Yeah, absolutely confirm what Stephen has said there. It is an adjustment and a non-cash adjustment. The Scottish Government Finance Directorate discussed with HM Treasury each year the requirements for Scotland in respect of adjustments like this, and we have always been included in that, and we communicate with them regularly to highlight what our requirement will be for this year. So I don't expect or anticipate any rejection of that. It's always supported because it's a non-cash adjustment, and it's part of an accounting standard and an accounting treatment that we need to adopt in our annual accounts.
Just to clarify in my own mind, I have the vision that down in Westminster and Treasury, there's a big pot of liabilities that they've taken in from across the four nations, and that's sitting there in Treasury. How do they account for it?
There'll be a combination. So there is accounting, you know, in the individual public bodies, and then there will be accounting on a UK basis as well, Chair. So HM Treasury's accounts, and then, which of course are audited by the National Audit Office, will disclose what the annually managed expenditure budget has been and the call against it. So in totality, and then that will be recorded. And then, of course, there are the whole of government accounts for the UK as well, in which we'll capture the deal of assets and liabilities. What we don't have, Chair, though, is that for many of the schemes, is that there'll be accounting really for their own basis. So the local government pension scheme will produce its own accounts that are audited by, at the moment, Audit Scotland. Those are disclosed of all the assets and liabilities of the scheme. Then the respective members of that scheme will make very extensive disclosures in their own accounts. So in Audit Scotland's annual reporting accounts, we have many pages of pension disclosures that set out what our respective share of those liabilities are. And they're also, as the Commission know, are subject to annual audit too. So in the round, there's a number of components of assurance about where the budget is disclosed, along with the pots of assets and liabilities.
Thank you. At this point, can I bring Mark Ruskell in?
Yeah, thanks, Chair. I'm content with those answers to your question. But I was just going to ask a wider question about pension governance within the Lothian Pension Fund and what role you play in that as an employer, or indeed what role the members of the scheme play in that governance, given that many of those people will be, you know, existing employees or former employees of yourselves. So I don't know if Stephen or Stuart want to answer that one.
Thanks, Mr. Ruskell. I'll start actually, and Stuart may want to follow. We are the external auditors, so the Accounts Commission appoint the external auditors of the Lothian Pension Fund. That function to, but I apologise, I should say actually that we appoint the auditors. I think that, strictly speaking, the auditors are actually one of the firms that we appoint as the external auditors. In terms of our engagement thereon with the pension governance arrangements, I think we're always mindful that although we're an employer member, we're also the external, or we appoint the external auditors, and there therefore needs to be an appropriate distance and not in any way to compromise the independence of external audit. Stuart can say a bit more about in a second how we manage that and what engagement we have directly with the Lothian Pension Fund. The Commission may be familiar, in recent years there's been some fairly significant changes in public pension governance arrangements. The creation, if I recall rightly, probably in the last 5 or 6 years of pension boards that has sought to increase representation from employers, employee member representation to inform and shape some of the workings of public pension funds. The success of those arrangements is a matter for review of, by the individual pension funds, that they publish annual reports, there's governance reviews, and forth, all of which seek to further the agenda that people who are members of the fund, whether as employers or employees, can better inform and understand very significant sums of public money are being used, recognising that these liabilities and assets will exist for many generations to come. If Mr. Ruskell is content, I'll maybe just invite Stuart to see if there's anything he wishes to say about Audit Scotland's engagement.
Thank you, Stephen. All I would add is that Lothian Pension Fund prepare a pension strategy each year document that we see as an employer. And as the Auditor General said, I would confirm that as we are an audit body, we don't feel it appropriate for any of our members of staff to be a member of the Lothian Pension Fund. So even though it is appointed as an external firm at this stage, that's the approach that we take. But we do are involved in pension strategy, and they contact us regularly from Lothian Pension Fund to ensure that we're content with the way they're operating.
Do you want to continue the questioning there, Mark? No. Okay. Are there any other members that would like to ask any questions on the spring budget revision? No. Then I'll thank the witnesses, and we'll move on to agenda item 3, which is consideration of Audit Scotland's budget proposal for 2022-23. Members have a copy of the budget proposal in their papers. We have the same witnesses for this agenda item. So I would firstly invite the Chair of the Board, Alan Alexander, to make any short introductory remarks, followed by the Auditor General.
Thank you, Convener. Sorry, thank you, Chair. And good morning to you and to the other members of the Commission. We are, as ever, happy to talk through the proposal and to answer any questions that you have for us. As you know, and as we all know, the pressure on public services and public finances is more intense than any of us has ever experienced. Public bodies, political leaders, public managers are juggling the difficult tasks of dealing with an ongoing and volatile pandemic. And the last 10 days have shown us just how volatile it can be. And with planning Scotland's recovery from the health and social and economic damage of the past 2 years. All of this has created significant additional pressures on Scotland's public bodies. These come on top of major stresses and systemic and strategic challenges that they already faced, such as maintaining financial sustainability, public service provision in a time of increasing demand, and economic and health inequalities. The response to this has led to increases in public spending and the overhaul and redesign of public services at previously unimaginable scale and pace. over the past year and a half, Audit Scotland has had to respond to these challenges. We've had to grow, as you know, and to change rapidly in order to do the bigger and more complex job that's now required of us. And this has to be done while we maintain and safeguard the robustness and independence of public audit in Scotland. We've made significant changes to how we work and to ensure that we have the skills and resources for now and into the future, and to protect the safety and well-being of our workforce. So I'd like to acknowledge in this context the support that the Commission has given us to make this possible. As Scotland's public bodies navigate the recovery and the transformation of services, our role in supporting improvements, providing assurance and shining a spotlight on the significant risks will be even more crucial than ever. I'll leave it there, Chair, and with your permission, I'll hand over to Stephen Boyle to speak in his capacity as Accountable Officer for Audit Scotland. Thank you.
Thanks, Alan. Chair, as Professor Alexander outlined and as is discussed in our budget proposal, over the past 2 years, the scope and scale of our responsibilities have grown at a rate not seen since we were first established in 2000. Public spending in Scotland has increased by about a fifth. Public bodies remain very stretched. Financial risks and issues facing Scotland are now much bigger, and the role of audit has never been more important. Our job has become more complex, and we need to ensure we have the resources, skills and capacities to fulfil our role now and into the future. Our budget proposal reflects that. We are making good progress, and over the past year and a half, we have recruited and strengthened many aspects of our organisation. We have invested in new ways of working and been clearer on our priorities. Through all of this, we have continued to deliver annual audits of hundreds of public sector organisations and a comprehensive and flexible programme of performance auditing on matters of significant public interest. This has not been easy, Chair, and I want to thank all of my Audit Scotland colleagues and those in our partner firms sincerely for all of their work. Public bodies are facing intense pressure. Staff have been diverted to frontline services, large amounts of money have moved rapidly through the system, and the financial controls that are integral to ensuring that public money is spent properly have been variable. These issues flow through to the audit. Auditors are reporting unprecedented numbers of corrections, accounts, and Commission members will be familiar with some of the details I've reported to Parliament through my Section 22 reporting in that respect. Looking forward, we are focused on both on Scotland's recovery and on our own needs as an organisation. We embrace the significant demands upon us and also make the most of the opportunities to shape our future, both ensuring the safety and equality of opportunity of our colleagues. Our resource requirement for 2022-23 is £11.6 million, an increase of £573,000 or 5.3% in real terms. Our total proposed budget for 2022-23 is £30.6 million. Our proposal contains more details on the areas that we will deliver for this public money. It includes assurance over the significant new sums of money and how well it's being used. We'll continue to focus on other key issues such as inequalities and outcomes being delivered for public spending, climate change, economic recovery, amongst others. Audit Scotland must continue investing in digital infrastructure and other resources to support more agile and flexible ways of working. We must also attract and retain high quality people and ensure we have the right skills. And we will invest in new methods, tools and approaches and support this with the right training and development. Chair, we're also clear that everything we do, both now and in the future, must be built on principles of well-being, quality, equality and sustainability. As ever, Chair, my colleagues and I look forward to the Commission's questions and we'll do our best to answer them.
Thank you, Auditor General. Perhaps I can just open up with the first question. Back in January 2021, the SCPA approved your budget proposal for 21-22, which included a request for an increase in contingency to £2.4 million, which was to implement long-term sustainable resource programme to meet the needs and demands of public audit. Now, I'm not going to go through this line by line and talk about what parts have been allocated to what. But you did say then that if, in response to questions, if you identify any potential underspend against this budget allocation, we will indicate this at the earliest opportunity for a return to the Scottish Consolidated Fund. So the question on that is that, having made that undertaking, the latest management contingency update letter appears to suggest that £107,000 of non-recurring surplus has been used to secure time-limited external support. Now, in relation to the £500,000 management contingency sought for 22-23, are you able to expand on the types of unplanned financial risks it could be used for? And again, will any underspend be returned to the Scottish Consolidated Fund? So basically, why haven't you returned the surplus money from last year, and are you given the same undertaking this year?
Thank you, Chair. I'm delighted to start now, actually. I might ask Martin Walker, who has been overseeing the infrastructure and the programme management that we've put around, how we've been spending the additional budget allocation that the Commission agreed in last year's budget, to say a bit more on top of the detail that I provide. So, to answer your questions in reverse, if I may, Chair, yes, we make the same undertaking that if Audit Scotland doesn't spend the money that the Commission affords us in approving our budget, we would return that money absolutely back to the Commission fund. And that would always be remain the case, is that our call and our request for our budget is built up on expectation of how we will spend it. And as the Commission generously supported our budget bid last year with the unprecedented challenges that public bodies, including ourselves, and were facing last year, our submission last year was designed to support Audit Scotland to provide public assurance on how well that money was being spent, recognising the hugely significant scale of change of public spending that's taking place over the course of the past 2 years, as we touch on in the proposal, that jumped from £40 billion to £55 billion of spending. As I referred to in my introductory remarks, that the need for assurance on how that money has been spent in quite different ways, at different scale and pace, with the control environment not always being as we would have expected in previous years, all of that required additional audit input to ensure that that money was being spent, and for us to report on it appropriately. How we've done that briefly, Chair, and Martin can say a bit more, is that we've invested in technology to ensure that we can support our colleagues to work remotely, as we've almost entirely been a virtual organisation in the intervening period. And we've also invested in our capacity. We've recruited additional auditors initially to deliver the responsibilities that we have. And we've also, in more recent months, sought to identify how, as an organisation, we are fit to deliver on our work, and investing in some of our corporate activities as well, our governance arrangements, our digital skills, the development of our audit methodologies. All of those activities have been funded and supported by the Commission's support from last year. Chair, I'll maybe pause, and because I know Martin want to come in and just give a bit some of the detail behind some of that spending, and hopefully assure the Commission.
Thank you, Stephen, and good morning, everybody. As the Auditor General said, the main focus and the main objective of resourcing and building our capacity in these areas has really been about two things. One has been about delivery, and the second has been about development. We were very conscious that during the course of the year, we needed to respond to the pressures that there were around delivering the audit work. And that's why the first phase of our capacity building project was very much focused on getting additional auditors into the mix. And with the Commission support and the funding that had been approved, we were able to bring in 24 additional auditors to get on with that work. Bringing in some of that resource also meant that we were able to free up a little bit of our existing capacity so that we were also able to invest in the future and put some of that resource into developing our audit methodologies, consider how we can best use digital audit techniques and so on, So we've used a combination of in the here and the now, but also focused on the future as well. The second phase of the building capacity, as Stephen said, was very much focusing on specialist and support skills. And so in more recent months, we've been going through a kind of rigorous process of considering various proposals from areas of the business, considering business cases to assess how appropriate those bids were, and then determine where those resources can be best used. And that, again, has been a combination of things. We've invested some more in audit quality, which is obviously very important to us, some of the corporate governance that Stephen mentioned, and also in some communications resource so that we're able to get our messages out effectively and efficiently, and really get the most value, if you like, out of the audit judgments that we're making. Beyond that, then, the last area is around technology that Steve mentioned. So we're keen to ensure that the digital provision that we've got in Audit Scotland is what all of our auditors need to be able to do their job effectively. Lastly, the one last area is to do with some short-term spending, which might involve getting in some external consultancy in particular areas where we think we might benefit from that. So, for example, we're looking to secure some support to help us inform our long-term office management strategy, because clearly as we move into this new ways of working and where hybrid working becomes much more prevalent than would ever been the case before, we think we might need some specialist advice around how we can move through from the current model of office provision to what a future model might look like. Couple of areas in addition to that as well, Chair, but hopefully that gives you a sense of what it is that we've used those resources for. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll bring Daniel Johnson in for a supplementary at this point.
Colin, the witnesses have just touched on resource points. If you were going to ask a question about that, I might come in after that rather than preempting that question if you were going to ask about that.
Oh. Some of that may come up in my next question.
Do you want to? Why don't you ask your?
You come in. You come in a moment. General, just continuing on the question of these resources, $1.5 million of the funding approved as contingency in 21-22 was used to recruit additional permanent positions. Now, was last year's request for management contingency effectively a request for additional staff, and therefore additional recurring budget? And, you know, I'm concerned about not mixing up here recurring and non-recurring contingencies.
I understand the nature of the question, Chair, and as the Commission will be familiar, we are largely a staff-led organisation in terms of how we deliver our activity. I think, as we describe, over 70% of our cost base is in respect of our staffing arrangements. So whilst we have recruited new colleagues to deliver our work, recognising that the budget uplift that the Commission supported us with, you know, is subject to review on an annual basis, and as we look to deliver our work, we would also point to the fact that we have a comprehensive workforce strategy and workforce plan. We have turnover in our organisation, allows us to adjust and allow for flexibility. So if the Commission felt it necessary that this was a time-limited budget, we would make the necessary provision and adjustments within our workforce plan to allow for that. It wouldn't be our preference, to be clear, Chair. I think that the overall challenges facing public audit, the scale of additional public spending, you know, in our view, necessitates this level of investment from the Commission, but if we needed to, then we would review our workforce plan and make those level of changes. But to deliver our audit work, we needed to recruit for colleagues to support that aspiration.
Original, in my mind, a contingency is more a one-off. It is not, you don't have a contingency as a recurring expense, which seems to be what most of this contingency is being utilised for. Would there not be a merit when you're asking for a contingency to say you're not actually asking for a contingency in case something happens, in case there's an unexpected expenditure or a half expected expenditure? You knew there was additional staffing needed, Why didn't you just apply for that in the budget?
I think we recognise your definition, Chair, of contingency. When we approached the Commission for the budget last year, probably recognising times that we were in and not knowing what would be expected of public spending and associated assurance, that we were grateful to receive the support through the contingency as how we managed it. But in terms of delivering the assurance required for the additional public spending, we could have taken two routes. One, we could have sought to go and recruit temporary staff to deliver that work, or else to recruit for on a more permanent basis. For me, I guess there's a couple of components to that. One is that our experience of recruiting temporary staff has been mixed, primarily in terms of audit quality, is that we typically are unable to recruit for the duration and quality of colleagues that we would want to join the organisation. And the other point is that I think is that we're, as I think it's alluded to in our earlier discussion, is I think we'd be able to de-risk that, and we'd be able to de-risk that as we move forward through the turnover that inevitably we have in the organisation as people move and take their careers elsewhere. So whilst we have recruited this year and continue to hope for the Commission's support, if that's what the Commission's minded to do for our overall budget, is that should you so decide that our budget would have a step change back to more recognisable levels, that we could accommodate that through our workforce arrangements. We're happy to discuss, you know, how we would best do that if that's what you felt.
Which brings me to the next point, is to what extent do these posts that you have recruited in 21-22, I mean, you're looking for a further 1.5 posts in 22-23, but looking at the posts that were added in 21-22, how many of them related to the global health emergency? If a substantial amount did, as opposed to the additional work and responsibilities that you were taking on anyway, can we expect the number of permanent posts to reduce in time as COVID-19 reduces and we see a recovery?
I'll ask Martin just to say a wee bit more about the specifics of the recruitment. We talked about how we had recruited on a phased basis to support our capacity. So the second phase was for specialist skills to, as in any organisation, requires, you know, a base level of specialist skills to ensure that the functioning of the organisation continues. Clearly there's a ratio between those two numbers. We also, if I digress for a second, Chair, is a consistency is that for the type of work that we do, we set ourselves high standards. The Commission probably expect us to be a well-functioning organisation, that our control environment, how we communicate, our governance arrangements are all operating effectively. We also need to invest in our digital skills. But in terms of the core of the recruitment that we've done, in terms of the audit work needed to deliver assurance on the vast sums of additional public spending, that was reflected in the first phase. So and what we haven't done is attributed of those 24 colleagues that Martin referred to say that this percentage relates to the global health emergency and a certain other percentage relates to previously agreed and committed investment through the programme that we referred to as the New Financial Powers Investment Programme, relating to the devolution of responsibilities to the Scottish Parliament and the creation of new bodies and so forth. But it would be clearly the case that the majority of our recruitment of auditors over the course of 21-22 has been in respect of the COVID-19 pandemic and the public audit response to that.
So, in simple terms, we'd expect the number of permanent posts to reduce over time.
I'm cautious about making that direct correlation, Chair, if I'm being honest, in that if all other things being equal, you could confidently predict that. But I think what we're also identifying, and as we touch on in our budget proposal, is that the auditing of public bodies, auditing profession, is changing. So we have to invest in digital skills. We'll have a response to climate emergency. We're also seeing very significant new quality and compliance expectations upon audit organisations, all of which would have been part of our discussions with the Commission had there not been for a pandemic. So I think what I'm effectively saying here in simple terms is I don't think the relationship is entirely linear, but if the pandemic disappeared overnight, which of course we all hope it would, is that then we would immediately revert back to our staffing cohort that existed pre-pandemic. I think we'd still want to continue discussions with the Commission that Public Audit in Scotland was suitably resourced with the skills and capacity that needed to respond to all the challenges that we're facing.
Now, the additional resources that you want in the 2022-23 budget, 1.5 posts, are these also for COVID-19 or are they for the actual audit itself, audit priorities?
Thanks, Chair. These posts relate to the, so they don't relate to COVID-19. They are in respect of previously agreed and discussed proposals around the public audit response to new financial powers and the devolution of responsibilities to the Parliament and our audit work. So it's a continuation of that investment as distinct from the COVID-19 public audit response.
Well, you're very clear on the 1.5. Surely you can separate out numbers that are put in place to respond to the COVID-19 issue as opposed to audit issues from the previous year.
We're happy to have a further look at that, Chair, and perhaps come back to the committee in writing. What we don't typically look to do is to say for the people that we recruited last year that they would work on COVID-19 and the others would work on new financial powers. It's safe to say in my mind that the majority, if not all, of the colleagues that we recruited would have been working on the public audit response to the pandemic, that we wouldn't ring fence a group of colleagues artificially, perhaps, in how we would manage their inputs. What we are saying, though, for these 1.5 posts this year is that it's that continuation of those new powers that Scotland have been provided with through the devolution and the audit response to that, really the continuation of that conversation that Audit Scotland has had with the Commission over and over.
Okay. Can I bring Daniel Johnson back in at that point?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the way you've brought me in. I didn't want to preempt your questions there because my follow-ups follow directly on from them. Stephen, you've quite, I think, rightly in the public domain said that it's vitally important that the Scottish Government acts with transparency when it comes to COVID-19 money and how that is spent, both in terms of how it planned expenditure and actually how it's delivered. Indeed, in the submission here, you talk about following the public pound. I'm just wondering, you know, following on from the answers there, whether you are doing that. And I accept that it might not be about having designated people as being the people that are doing the quote-unquote COVID-19 work, but there surely must be activities that you're undertaking because of COVID-19. And so while it might not be discrete individuals or resource that are allocated to COVID-19 activities, you must be able to identify the percentage of work in each audit that you're undertaking or other work that you're undertaking that is due to the pandemic. So is that the case? Is that identified? Are you tracking it? And indeed, you know, is there a kind of a need for you to look at what activities you're undertaking because of COVID-19 so that you can manage and track that?
Thanks, Mr. Johnson. I'm very, very happy to say a word or two about your points that you're making. And Stuart Dennis might want to come in, actually, just to give the Commission a bit more detail about some of our tracking and monitoring arrangements. The first point you make about, you're quite right, is that I have not been slow in encouraging public bodies to be open and transparent in their spending of public money. And the same absolutely applies to how Audit Scotland affairs, that we are clear with the Commission, Parliament, users of public services, that we are held to the same standard that, we pass comment on, other organisations. The COVID-19 activities are dispersed across all aspects of our work. That's entirely unavoidable. And we have, over the course of the past now 20 months, we've done, I suppose, two things. One is that we have changed our performance audit best value programme. So we have produced a number of, we've identified as new reports on how COVID money has been spent. We've done a series of trackers in terms of publications. We also have a dedicated website of an e-hub of, related to COVID activity. And we'll continue to do that really through all aspects of our work. We've got overview reports on the NHS in Scotland and local government that will be published early in the new year. In terms of our tracking of the money, the auditors, how well that's been spent, we've got a further significant report due in May of next year, really this taking stock of how all the public money has been spent. And that's informed really by the annual audit work, so that as we look to touch in our budget submission, annual audits are still taking longer, and that's almost entirely due to the pandemic. The vast sums of money have reached local authorities that have to be audited. They've also gone to enterprise agencies, other public bodies. All of that work is COVID related as well. The audits are still taking longer, Mr. Johnson, is another feature of the pandemic too. And that also requires more audit input. It requires more judgment about the public money that's being spent as well. So all of that is hopefully a reflection indication to the Commission that the impact of the pandemic is touching all aspects of our work, but it matters that we are tracking and monitoring and recording how we do that. And I'm happy, maybe I suggested that Stuart Dennis might want to come in, but I'm conscious perhaps that Professor Alexander might also want to say a word about how we are reporting and assuring our own board about how that money has been spent too. Happy, Chair, at your discretion to perhaps go to Professor Alexander first and then to Stuart Dennis.
Please do.
Are we okay? Should I come back in with a question?
Andy, are you online now?
I am now, yes.
Would you like to comment as the Auditor General suggested?
If you could say it again, I had an away from keyboard moment, so I didn't hear that.
I tell you what I might do, I was wanting to come back on something that that Stephen had said anyway, and maybe he can repeat his question and the answer to that. Just in terms of the delay to the audit work, can I just ask what the sort of the broad balance is between, I think we can understand that there's complexity because you're having to do audit work remotely and you know, social distancing and so on. So there's a sort of a productivity issue there just inherent because of COVID restrictions. But what's the split between that and actually the fact that the nature of the activities being undertaken by public body and the way that they're being funded because of extraordinary COVID funding is making your audit work more complicated. It's more difficult to follow the audit trail because of the nature of the. Is there a sense which you have of that split? And indeed, is there something else I've missed in terms of my assessment as to why audit may be taking longer?
All of those things are relevant, Mr. Johnson. So there is remote auditing. So as the Commission will have heard me say already, that we became a virtual organisation almost overnight in March of last year. We have periodically made access to our offices available as the pandemic restrictions allowed, had done that a little bit over the course of the autumn, and now have reverted back to been entirely virtual again over the course of the past few weeks. So remote auditing has been a factor. I think it's also relevant to point out that when lockdowns have been at their most significant, and that schools were closed in particular, that has caused a real disruption as colleagues had assumed caring responsibilities. And also I would say that the same applies to public bodies colleagues as well, as they similarly would be able to, by necessity, be less productive. They also had caring responsibilities. All of those things are factors, not just for audit really, but for any workplace. We touched on also about the quality of the accounts that we've received for audit. We would say, and certainly from the feedback that we've had directly from our auditors this year, is that we are making the most significant amount of audit recommendations and adjustments that many of us have done at any stage here. And some of that will be as a consequence of the additional sums that have been received and the money that's flown through the system at real pace by necessity that we would recognise. And that is also causing delay, but it isn't a universal picture. I think that's the point I would stress to the Commission, is that some public bodies have been able to prepare their accounts and the audit has been delivered on the original timescale pre-pandemic, but for others, they are taking considerably longer. By way of illustration, that all of the central government audits are expected to be laid in Parliament by the end of December. I think for the first time there will be two central government bodies that won't meet their laying deadline of the end of this month. We also have a number of local authority audits that are also still continuing. So we've often used the phrase unprecedented in recent months, but none of us can recall yet that any of audits still going on beyond the calendar year that the audit started. So all of these have been factors as to why the audits are taking longer. We anticipate, we hope that there will be a recovery of summer timescales next year, but probably more realistically, it will be for the start of the next audit appointment round that we will work to recover the timescales of earlier financial reporting in conjunction with public bodies.
Daniel, do you want to continue your questioning?
I think I may leave it there, Convener. I've got one question that I may come in on in terms of what was alluded to in terms of the investments, but that may get covered off by a colleague, so I'll leave it there for now.
Okay. Can I bring Sharon Dowie in, please?
Thanks, Chair. Good morning, everybody. I think actually, Auditor Jane, you've maybe just answered my first question there, which was, what's your latest estimate of when you'll catch up with the audit work delayed because of the disruption from the pandemic?
Yeah, I think I would have been perhaps more confident in my answer to you, Deputy Chair, if you'd asked me this 2 or 3 weeks ago. Having now, as we've all seen, with further restrictions and variant, be less confident in what I would say, is that our plan had been that 2022 would have been a year of progress, if not recovery of timescales. 2023, we would anticipate reverting to what we would have recognised as the more traditional deadlines for the completion of the audit. Perhaps for the Commission's information, we're not alone in these circumstances. We know from previous conversations that we engage regularly with the other UK audit agencies, and that they are also experiencing delays and complexity in the audit. So it's a factor of the people, the quality of the accounts that we receive for audit, and the need for audit quality and the assurance that work that we will give to the public and to our respective parliaments. All of that needs to be done properly, but we have a plan. We'll make changes to that given the circumstances that we're facing. But I fear it will take a little bit longer now to recover entirely to the timescales that we've been.
Yeah, thanks. In the report as well, it explained that you can only charge for work that's been undertaken. Catching up also infers that there may be an element of additional fee income from work undertaken in 2022-23. But which relates to audits from previous years. To what extent does the budget proposal include fees or fee income arising from audits related to previous years, as well as fee income from work undertaken in 2022-23.
Happy to start now, and I suspect Stuart Dennis will want to say a word or two just about some of the flow of funds in respect of previous years. If I may, in terms of fee income represents a significant component of Audit Scotland's budget. About two-thirds of our income comes from fees that we charge where we're able to for the annual audit work. We've got a significant group of audits are non-chargeable, and the audit fee is covered by the Commission's budget approval. You'll see in the budget proposal that we're anticipating broadly about a 2% fee setting for across the various different sectors, that we've analysed some of the ranges that are not entirely consistent from one body to another. There is a bit of flexibility to charge additional fees where we need to as part of our audit arrangements. It really reflects that if there are circumstances where we haven't received either a high quality set of unaudited accounts, high quality working papers, that the support to the audit of officials being able to answer audit queries in with the usual deadlines and so forth. If that's not been the case, we say in all of our documentation that we reserve the right to charge additional fees, Ms. Dow. But as I'll pause and just see if Stuart can supplement that with just any further detail or comment that he wishes.
Thanks, Stephen. Yeah, just a couple of points to raise, and I think some of it might have been on the last question raised as well, is that 2021 has been the first audit year that we've done completely remotely. 1920 was a partial year, and so this year we'll get a clear picture of exactly how long remote audit actually takes from start to finish. I think the 1920 was a year where we had started audits on the old way of working, and then we had to finish off due to the pandemic remotely. So in respect of comparison of days and the amount of resource it's taken, I think we'll have a bit clearer picture on completion of the 2021 audits. As Stephen said, I think we need to be a bit prudent in respect of the fees. We will expect some element of catch-up, but not to levels that we previously had. As Stephen alluded to, we are not in a position where we think that we'll go back to how we used to operate and be at that position for the next financial year. So the budget does assume a small element of catch-up, but not to the extent of where we were previously. And I think, as I said, the last couple of weeks are evidence of that, with what's happening with the latest variant, that you can't accurately predict anything at all in this. So you have to be very careful in respect of financial management. Hope that answers your question.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks. In paragraph 65, Audit Scotland advises that it expects its headcount will increase further as we continue to identify key areas requiring further investment. How many additional posts are expected in addition to its headcount of 330? And have the cost of the additional posts been included in the budget projections for 2023-24 and 2024-25? On table 1 and page 10 of the budget proposal.
Thank you. I'll invite Martin to come in to say a wee bit more, Deputy Chair, about how we have constructed the proposal in the second and our expectations for future years. The certainty that we're able to offer probably isn't as much as we would hope if we're being. I think what we have looked to do is to identify the components that we, in future years, and setting aside the specifics of the detailed proposal for this year, is that the environment that we're operating in is really volatile, with the pace of adoption of technology, application of our digital auditing strategy, and also the investment that we've made in audit quality in particular, that we can assure the Commission, that Audit Scotland assures myself as Auditor General and the Accounts Commission of the quality of our work. So we've captured that in our submission this year, but our plans, as I mentioned earlier, in terms of our workforce plan, we keep that under regular review so that we are reflecting our financial spending. Colleagues that we put and employ to deliver that are all in tandem. But I'll pause for a moment just if Martin is able to say a little bit more about where that might lead us in subsequent years of our budget submission.
Thank you, Auditor General. You're absolutely right. The accuracy with which we can predict our workforce projections over the course of the next couple of years, it is quite difficult. You know, in previous years there was much more predictability, and we could anticipate and plan for changes in a much more in a much more accurate way, probably. I think what I can say is that what we've got in the budget submission here today is, in the current situation and with the uncertainties being as they are, this is our best estimate of what the workforce will look like over the years to come. I think we're at a stage at the moment where some of the things that we're currently investing in, like digital auditing and looking at what new ways of working look like in practice, we're almost in a transition stage. So while we would want to get efficiencies from those processes, at the moment it's quite difficult necessarily to be able to pin those down. So we might like to see a kind of curve, if you like, that goes up and then starts to drop as those new ways of working really come into effect. But as we sit here at the moment, it's really quite difficult to predict with as much accuracy as we would like. It is absolutely the case, however, that as the Auditor General says, we keep this stuff under regular review. We recast the workforce projections on an annual basis as a minimum. And as we demonstrated in this year, we've also sought to be as flexible as we can in being able to kind of respond to the challenges that we're facing at the moment, while at the same time ensuring that we're keeping very close tabs on what's happening there. There was a question earlier on in terms of, you know, how it is that the board keeps itself assured of how all this is playing out. And if it's helpful, I could say a little bit about that. The board and the audit committee get quarterly update reports in terms of our performance, in terms of our financial performance, and also in terms of risk. So that is a well-established pattern of reporting that we've sustained during the course of the pandemic, because we were very clear that, you know, there are certain good matters of governance that need to continue even in quite challenging circumstances, and that's what we did. Over and above that, thinking about the impact of COVID, we actually produce an update report for every meeting of the board, which assesses the impact in terms of the impact that the pandemic is having on the audit process and audit delivery, and also the organisational impacts of COVID as well, in terms of how it's impacting our people and how we're responding to all of that. So as I say, the board gets an update report on that at each and every one of its meetings, and they're all published on our website. So I think from that, hopefully you will take assurance that we're, you know, monitoring things carefully, and also that we're very keen to ensure that the board has all the information it needs to assure itself that we're responding in an appropriate way.
Yeah, that's fine. You've kind of touched on my last one then. So the last question I was going to ask, which you'd mentioned earlier, Auditor General, about the staff costs, which are about 70% of your expenditure. So there's a lot of increased costs there, and the fees paid to the professional services firms that perform the audit work on Audit Scotland's behalf are likely to have significant increases, and are subject to significant uncertainties. So the last question was, to what extent has Audit Scotland's budget for 2022-23 recognised the budgetary impact of increased inflation, given the potential for higher than anticipated staff cost increases and significantly increased fees payable to professional services firms? But from your last answer there, I take it that's all been taken into account when you've done the budget.
As much as we've been able to, I will, if I'll invite Professor Alexander to come in a wee second. I think he'll want to say a little bit more about that as through his chairing of our board, but also through his work in chairing the procurement arrangements, the new audit appointment steering group, and say a bit more about where we're at. But there is uncertainty. I think it's the point I would make, Deputy Chair, about what our costs might be after we have completed the procurement for audit services, reflecting the mixed market of approach that we have for undertaking the external audit of public bodies in Scotland, where, broadly speaking, Audit Scotland staff conduct about 2/3 of the audit work, and a third or so is undertaken by firms appointed by myself and the Accounts Commission. We're right in the midst of that tender arrangement at the moment, so we don't know yet quite what the detail of the firm's bids will be. Broadening that out, I think what we've seen is a direction of travel across external audit, both in the public and private sector, that fees are increasing because of increasing compliance arrangements, increasing complexity, demands, expectations. What we've set out in the budget proposal is a plan that we'll continue to engage with the Commission, but that the impact of that will be known quite clearly more in time for the next time we have the budget submission with the Commission for our 23-24 budget. We will see those costs coming through. Of course, we'll continue to update you. Just very briefly before I hand to Professor Alexander, is that in terms of our own costs for Audit Scotland employees, that references the fee increase that we would pay the firms under the existing arrangements. We've made some assumptions about a pay award in our budget submission. We've referenced what we know of other parts of the public sector, the pay awards that they might make, formed up to a point by the Scottish Government's pay policy, but also more widely about the need for us to invest in to recruit, but also retain high quality, high skilled people, so that our market is different, and we have to reflect all of those parts so that we can continue to deliver all the audit work that's required of us. I'll pause there, Deputy Chair, and just invite Professor Alexander if he wishes to say any more.
Thanks very much indeed, Stephen. Two main points about the oversight that the board gives to the entire budget process, and indeed to the entire decision-making process in Audit Scotland. Stephen referred a few moments ago to the procurement round that's just coming to its conclusion. We hope to appoint new auditors in the first quarter of next year to take effect from the beginning of the next financial year. Back in 2019, February, the board, before I became chair, asked me to chair a steering group to do two important things. One was to revise the code of audit practice, which underpins the entire audit process. And the other was to organise the procurement of auditors from private firms who do about 1/3 of the audit work for which we are responsible. That process has been detailed oversight and detailed participation by the members of the board, with a report to each meeting of the board of where we've got to. In addition to that, I've instituted a practice of having board seminars where we look in some detail in a way which is unbound by the pressures of a complex agenda, but which underpins the way in which we give oversight to things like the budget submission. We had a seminar on risk towards the end of the summer, seminar on the development of the budget process and the assumptions underlying it, and we'll have other seminars in the coming year. I emphasise that to the Commission just to make up the point that certainly I and my independent members of the board don't come to the board and then forget about everything else that's happening. We have a continuing oversight, and I think we come with a deep understanding. And how can I put this? a positively critical eye on the proposals that come to us. Thanks, Chair.
Sean, do you have any other question to ask? I think Sean's frozen it. Ah, no. Thank you. I'm going to ask people to be really tight with their questions and answers because we are running a bit over time. I'm going to bring Mark Ruskell in.
Yeah, thanks, Kavina. So I'd just like to quickly go back to a point Martin was making around the future operating model and around the offices. You've obviously got the three offices, Edinburgh, Glasgow and Inverness, and I think you're undertaking a property review at the moment. Can you say a little bit more just around what the emerging conclusions are for that? I mean, are you going to need these three properties in the long term? Are the changes that you've made as a result of COVID going to stick in terms of the need for less office accommodation? Can you just give us a very quick flavour of where you think that's going in terms of your need for these bases going forward?
Thanks, Mr. Ruskell. I'm happy to start. Actually, you mentioned Martin may want to say a word or two as well. We will be doing the property review, and we started our thinking on that. As we touched on with the committee commission previously, is that we're tied into leases currently for the three sites that we have, all of which end in successive years from 2025, if I recall, onwards. We've consulted with our colleagues regularly over the course of the pandemic through pulse surveys periodically to test their views about ways of working and so forth. We're continuing to do that. I think by all expectations that we'll likely move to not exclusively a virtual model that we're in as we speak, but more likely a hybrid set of arrangements that is more flexibility for how people undertake their work, that we're providing the right service and expectation to the public bodies that we audit, mindful of our net zero aspirations too. All of that speaks to the likelihood is that we will still have an office estate of some description in how we deliver our work, but probably not in the guise entirely that we currently do. Unfortunately, as we go through that process, we're still incurring costs and we're still paying rent for the three sites that we have. It is worth the Commission's insight to hear that we've just about completed our rent negotiations on our Edinburgh office too. And contrary to expectations about the demand for commercial property in Edinburgh, after a long period of negotiations, is that our rent will be increasing slightly for that site for the duration of our lease in accordance with that contract. So I think in totality, it will look and feel different in the future, but likely as we build up to that point until we have the break points in the respective leases for those three offices.
Okay, thanks. I don't know if Martin's got any very brief comments to add to that.
Thank you, if I may. Yeah, I think with this kind of thing, timing is everything. As we know, there are still some significant uncertainties and in some respects, there's competing pressures as well. As Stephen said, we've done a number of surveys with colleagues and it is very clear that hybrid working is very much the future preference for the vast majority of our colleagues. And you know, that makes perfect sense in many respects. And that would typically take you in the direction of assuming, therefore, that we would need a reduced office footprint. You know, we would need less space. I'm sure that will be a factor. It's also the case that as things develop and as we still need to manage through the pandemic, there is a competing pressure, which is any restrictions around social distancing. And we've always sought to achieve, you know, really good social distancing standards there. That has a opposite effect, if you like, in that it suggests that, well, the footprint might not actually reduce as much you might originally think if there is to be some form of social distancing maintained into the longer term. Now, clearly, there's a big uncertainty about that at the moment. I think what we are keen to do, though, is look at all options. And this is where the green agenda is very important here as well, in that we need to consider whether having the three larger offices is the right model in the long term, and whether there may be other models that we need to consider, which is smaller satellite offices which provide more ready access to people, you know, across the country. We have people spread right across the country. And pre-pandemic, you know, people would travel into those offices. We need to think carefully about whether or not that's a sensible model going forward. We know from the survey and the feedback that we've got from colleagues, one of the things that people have really liked out of the pandemic, and there aren't many of these things, it has to be said, but one of the things that has been a real learning point and a real thing that people have benefited from is the absence of commuting and spending that all of that time each day traveling to a work location. And that is absolutely one of the things that we want to hold on to. We don't want to revert and snap back to type before, because there are some good things that have come out of all this, and we need to use that to inform our thinking for the future. So we need to look at a broad range of options for this. And as I say, the timing will be really quite important. We've got the break points in the leases, and hopefully by those points, we'll be in a much clearer position in terms of what we expect our, you know, office estate footprint will need to be, and importantly, what our colleagues are expecting and needing from office space. I think it's true to say that, you know, office space or what gets done in offices in the future will not necessarily be the same as how it used to be in the past. So apologies, I've possibly given a bit too much information there, but it's give you a bit of a flavour of our thinking at the moment.
No, that's fine. I mean, it sounds like exciting opportunities for staff and potential cost reductions as well. So happy place to be in. Can I just ask you then about something very specific within the budget? And that's the $660,000 for governance. Can you just very briefly just explain what sits under that figure?
I think maybe just to start. Yeah, I was usually just going to invite Martin to talk you through that as it sits under his area of responsibility.
Thank you, Auditor General. So that covers a broad range of areas. As you would imagine, for an organisation that sets high expectations in terms of good governance, then that is absolutely something that we apply to ourselves as well. There's a range of areas that come under this. It's about supporting the board and all of the business of the board and its committees and so on, and the various support services that are involved in supporting that process. It includes things like our performance management arrangements, our risk management arrangements, and all of the work that goes into that to ensure that we're really operating as effectively as we can be, and that we're meeting the kind of aspirations that we expect of others.
Do you see any way to reduce that figure going forward?
I think we're always looking to you know, deliver efficiencies where we can. So as we do in all areas of the audit work and the whole running of the organisation, you know, all these things we keep under careful and close review. Again, we may find that as we make more and greater use of technology, there are some opportunities for efficiencies that we get from that. Even you know, as members will be very aware of the issue of holding meetings and all the expense that can go with that has been very different under the pandemic situation. But it may be that we need to continue to look at how we can again retain some of the things that have worked and have perhaps been more efficient through the course of the pandemic as we, you know, develop the new ways of working in the future. So absolutely keep all that stuff under review all of the time.
Okay. And then just one last detailed question, probably for yourself, Martin. I mean, we sort of noticed in the report that the sort of payment per hour for the audit support officers has gone from £41 an hour down to £38 an hour. Can you sort of explain what's going on there?
So the short answer is no. I wouldn't want to try and bluff an answer for you there. It may be something that Stuart can help with, or if not, it's something that we can provide some information on the back of this meeting, if that's helpful.
Yeah, that would be good. Okay, back to you, convener.
Thank you, Mark. Could you now bring Richard Leonard in, please?
Thanks, Chair, and good afternoon, Auditor General. I've just got one very quick question, really, which is, under other administrative costs, paragraph 68 of the budget proposals, we are told that there's an increase of £220,000 in respect, I quote, of the biennial national fraud initiative. I wonder whether, Stephen, you could explain how that's calculated. Is it an increase of £220,000 for additional staff recruitment, for additional services to be brought in? And can you also just explain for our benefit, if we look at page 19 of the budget appendix 2, there is a table there with various budget lines. I wonder whether you could explain to us under which budget line that expense sits. Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Leonard. Yeah, taking your questions in reverse, in appendix 2, the National Fraud Initiative is identified under the audit quality analysis line. So if that has under the 829,000, so the additional £220,000 that that we're requesting for the budget is part of that analysis. So Stuart, I'm sure, will want to say a little bit more about the, how we spend the £220,000. But you rightly say this is a spend that almost yo-yos in and out of our budget request to the Commission, by reflecting the biannual nature of the activity. And so what we don't go and recruit new people to come and work on the National Fraud Initiative, then they leave us and then we rehire. But there are costs associated with the running of the activity, and very direct costs associated with the engagement that we have in using the activities and the arrangements for the Cabinet Office, who oversee the overall the National Fraud Initiative. So it's a fairly consistent model of spend pattern in our budget that it appears, it disappears, and then comes back. If you're happy, Mr. Leonard, maybe ask Stuart just that you can talk the Commission through just about some of that analysis of how that 220 is made up.
Yeah, that'd be helpful.
Thanks, Stephen. Yes, the 220 is our contribution to the Cabinet Office for all the data sets of the public bodies in Scotland that provide information as part of the database and the NFI matching exercise. So that is our, what we do is we pay for the whole of the public sector in Scotland. That was the agreed arrangement, and that's what we do for that. And as the Auditor General said, that's every 2 years. So the last one we did was in 2020. There'll be due a report on the NFI matches probably next year at some point, as the matches are identified and what findings there has been. I mean, the last report that we did was in July 2020, based on the 18-19, and that identified £15 million of fraud and error in the public sector in Scotland. And since the implementation of NFI in 06-07, in that report, we've identified £143 million as part of this exercise. Obviously, that is likely to increase once the data match for the 2020 exercise is done. And then what will happen in 2022 is this is the payment as the data sets are sent into the Cabinet Office to coordinate. Hope that answers the question.
Yes, it does. I think that's helpful. But and any money recovered as a result of the National Fraud Initiative presumably goes back to those bodies who have been defrauded. It doesn't come back to Audit Scotland, does it?
No, it goes back to the bodies. It's identified, and the bodies will try and get the money back that's been identified as the errors.
But I guess my point is, you have to pay a fee to get the data sets, but in so doing, and you track fraud, you don't get any recovery of that fee that they have to put in.
No, that's correct. That was the agreed method that we decided, I think, in Scotland to do a number of years ago. So that was the preferred method, that it would be easier to be coordinated in one location, and Audit Scotland was the appropriate body to do that, instead of having lots of independent payments and invoicing. This was deemed the most efficient and effective method to undertake NFI.
Thanks, Chair. Back to you.
Thank you, Richard. I am conscious of the time. I do have another couple of questions myself. What I'll propose to do is send these through the clerks to Audit Scotland, and we'll circulate responses when received. Do any other members have any other points they would like to bring out at this time? Stephen, I see you've got an R in the box there. Did you have something you would like to say?
Yeah, that's very generous of you. I was just going to say a word or two about NFI, really, to Mr. Leonard's point about the benefits. So whilst in financial terms they don't accrue back to Audit Scotland, I think we're generally content with those arrangements, that you know, the public body's participation and their full engagement really matters. You know, so we report on that, as Stuart mentioned, on the biannual reporting of it, but they also accrue the financial benefits and the deterrent impact as well on NFI. So I think disrupting that relationship, I guess we're kind of mindful of the risk of unintended consequences that it might not be all that would have been wanted from kind of changing the fee arrangement for NFI. That was all, Chair. Thank you.
Thank you for that. No other members have indicated they would like to carry on with any questions. So I would say that concludes our evidence session, and I'll thank all our witnesses for their evidence. And of course, that also concludes the public part of today's meeting. Maybe members like a couple of minutes comfort break as we resume in private session, consider the evidence heard. Thank you very much. Oh, and Merry Christmas.